PPS, what are the various modes of coal transportation? Why the merry-go-round system is advantageous over a conventional way of coal transportation by rail? Second question, explain in brief various modes of coal transportation used for thermal power plant. Answer, the various modes of coal transportation used for thermal power plants are as follows. Transportation by sea or river with the help of ships, barge, transportation by rail, transportation by ropeways, transportation by road, by pipeline. First, transportation by sea or river with the help of barge. If the power plant is situated on the bank of a river or near the sea shore, it is often economical to transport the coal by the ships or barge. The coal brought by the ships is unloaded mechanically by cranes or grab bucketers at the site of the power plant or the screw unloader. The merits. This mode is more economical than other modes of coal transportation. Demerits. The loading and unloading of a huge amount of coal to the ships are the major problems with the ship transport. Now, transportation by rail. The transportation of coal by rail is most important means of transportation in a common use. The coal supply to Indian power plant is mainly by the rail, as unfortunately river transportation is not available. Merits. This mode of transport plays a very important role for power stations which are located interior of the country. A railway siding line is taken to a power station and coal is either delivered to a storage yard or close to the point of consumption. Demerits. The ordinary rail track available like in India will not be able to supply the required coal to large power station. To overcome this deficiency, a unit train system has to come into existence. Now, transportation by ropeways. This is a very efficient method of transporting the coal from one mine to the power station. This is practically used where the distance between the mine and the power station is less than 10 kilometers. Merits. The major advantages of this system is it supplies the coal continuously and free from worker strikes, which is common with the rail transport. Now, transportation by road. The transportation of coal by road is used for the small capacity plant. The lorries used for coal transport are self-tripping. There are containers have usually one or two hydraulic cylinders which are actuated by the engine itself, and lorries are being emptied after the weighing is carried out on the weighing platform. By end tripping, either into a ground hoppers or on the belt conveyors underneath or on the open coal storage. The coal handling system used at Koradi power station in Maharashtra is typical one, as ropeways, railways and road transportation are used simultaneously to supply the coal to the power plant. Merits. The major advantages of road transport is the coal can be carried directly into the powerhouse up to the point of consumption. Now, transportation by pipeline. In the most of the countries, the power generating stations are far away from the coal mines and existing railway facilities are not sufficient to cope up with the increasing demand. The transportation of coal by pipeline is considered most speedily method among the all methods. Merits. It is continuous transportation system unaffected by the climate and weather. It is capable of transporting very large quantities of coal, that is 25 million tons per year, with the single pipeline. It is easy to carry a pipeline through a difficult terrain like hills, valleys, swamps compared with the other modes of transport. Manpower requirement is low and maintenance charges are also low. Losses of coal during the transportation due to the theft is totally eliminated. Now, requirement of a large area, as in the case of a railway system, or a site dumping and storage system is eliminated. It produces a least environmental disturbance as noise or the dust problem, and traffic congestion is drastically reduced. Also, it provides a simplicity in installation and increased safety in the operation. Now, demerits. It requires a large quantity of water, as 1 kg of coal requires 1 kg of water. The preparation of coal at a pumping terminal is as well as dewatering and recovery of the coal at the delivery terminal requires a high capital and operating cost. Consumers must be able to use a coal with an added surface moisture of 10%. This also results in some loss of useful heat of the coal. The merry-go-round system is advantageous over the conventional way of coal transportation by rail because in this system the train consists of 130 to 150 wagons. The wagon remains coupled and moves slowly round a large rail track section passing on one upon over a discharge pit. Each wagon is emptied without stopping the train, remain coupled during the both filling and the emptying operation. This ensures a fast turn round at each end of a journey by eliminating the time lost in coupling, uncoupling and tippling the wagons. Now explain the function of ESP. Functioning of ESP. ESP are used for removal of dust and ash particles carried with the exhaust gases of a thermal power plant. Functioning of ESP takes place as following manner. Electrical charging of particulates. Collection of charged particles on a grounded surface. Neutralization of a charged particles at a collector. Removal of the particles for disposal. The electrical charge is imparted to a particulate by passing the particles through a high voltage direct current corona. The high voltage field ionizes the gas molecules in the air stream, which in turn becomes attached to a particulate matter and gives them a negative charge. After being charged, the negative particles move towards the positive electrodes and the collected there. The charge is neutralized at the amount of collection and they can be removed from the collection surface by wrapping, washing or a plain gravity. The energy used for separating the particles from the waste gas stream by means of an ESP is expended solely upon the particulate, not on the gas stream itself, as is the case on most other collection of the control devices. Why the tank heating required for the furnace oil or a heavy oil? A tank heating is required for furnace oil or a heavy oil because the furnace oil increases in viscosity as the temperature decreases. This makes the handling of oil a little difficult, particularly in winter at a low ambient temperature of below 25 degrees Celsius. The furnace oil is not easily pumpable. Therefore, the tank heating of a furnace oil or a heavy oil is necessary. LDO and HSD does not require the tank heating as comparatively their viscosity is low and easily pumpable. So, what are the various types of conveyor belts used in a coal handling plant? Now, the various types of coal handling plant belts are: first is a belt conveyor, another is a screw conveyor, third is a bucket conveyors, fourth is a grab bucket conveyors, and fifth one is a flight conveyors. First thing, a belt conveyor. This is a very suitable means of transporting a large amount of coal over a large distance. The initial cost of this coal carrying system is not high and power consumption is also low. The rate of coal transfer can be easily varied by just varying the speed of the belt. It is not suitable for short distance and greater height. The screw conveyors. It requires a minimum space and it is cheap in the first cost. It is most simple and compact. The power consumption per unit weight transferred is considerably very high, but it is very good. And the bucket elevators. This conveyor is extensively used for vertical lifts. These are having number of buckets connected with a chain and they lift the coal and throw it at the elevated surface. Now grab bucket conveyors. It lifts as well as it transfers the coal from one point to another. The grab conveyor can also be used with the crane or the tower. Now flight conveyor. This conveyor is used only for the transfer of coal when filling a number of storage bins situated under the conveyor is required. Now what are the various condenser cooling water system used in a thermal power station based on the availability of water? explain one of them with a suitable diagram. The cooling water system are commonly used in a practice according to the availability water are listed below. Open or a once through system, and second one is a closed system. First is water cooling, second is a cooling ponds, cooling towers, and our second one is a air cooling, that is direct dry type cooling tower system, or a indirect air cooling system. Now we will discuss the once through or a open water cooling system. In this, the water is drawn directly from the upstream side of the river and pumped through the condenser and then discharged to the downward side of the river at the temperature 5 to 10 degree in excess of the inlet temperature. The temperature of the discharge water should be kept within the safe limits to prevent the harm to the fishes. The limit of the discharge water temperature is specified by the fisheries board. The arrangement of an open system is shown in figure as the position of inlet and outlet should be chosen in such a way that there should not be any recirculation of a hot water which impairs the efficiency of a condensing plant. Such recirculation is possible in a small rivers, canals, and therefore the distance between the inlet and the discharge point should be minimum 1 km or more than that. This type of cooling system can be used only where the required quantity of water is available throughout the year and in sufficient quantity. Now, second one is a closed system. When the enough quantity of water is not available for the cooling requirement from river, then the closed type system is universally adopted. In a closed system, the hot water coming out of the condenser is closed or recirculated either by spraying, or it is cooled by spraying in the pond or passing through the cooling tower instead of discharging to the downward side of the river. The quantity of water required is collected from the river during the flood period or when a sufficient water is available with the required purity. The same water is used again and again for the condenser by passing through the cooling towers. The arrangement is shown in figure, and this system of a cooling, also an external source of water is needed to replace the tower evaporation and carryover losses. The quantity of water lost by evaporation and the carryover varies between 2 to 5% of that circulated depending upon the design of a tower. Even a 5% of makeup water is appreciable quantity, that is 5000 tons per hour for 1000 megawatt capacity plant. Therefore, the power plant using the closed cooling system obtain their makeup water from rivers, and a similar intake arrangement is adopted on the smaller scale as used for open system. Now, how coal is converted into the electrical power? Explain with the help of schematic diagram. Now, the conversion of coal into the electrical power comprises of the following steps: combustion of a coal, second steam generation and conversion into the mechanical power, third is a feed water flow, and fourth one is the generation of electrical power. Now, combustion of coal. Coal is transported by rail, road, ropeways to the power station. The raw coal is stacked in the CHP, where it is crushed to a 25 mm size by the crusher. The crushed coal is transported by conveyor belts to the coal bunker, which are located above the coal mills. From bunkers, coal is fed to pulverizer or a coal mills, which grind it into a fine powder. The primary preheated air is supplied by primary air fans to the pulverizers, by which coal is dried and transported to a coal bunkers located at the corners of the boiler furnace. The additional amount of air called secondary air is supplied by FD fans through a wind box dampers located at the two sides of a furnace. The resultant product of a combustion are a flue gases which flows over the tube, and a fine ash is removed in the form of slurry. The flue gases are sucked by ID fan and discharged through a chimney at a high altitude to ambient air. Now steam generation and conversion to mechanical power. The heat released from the coal has been observed by the rail, by the water wall tubing, which lines the inside wall of a, lies in the inside wall of the boiler. The boiler feed water is fed to a water wall tubes from the boiler drum through a downcomer and bottom rings header. Then water absorbs the latent heat of evaporation and steam is formed in the tubes. The dry and saturated steam at a high pressure and temperature is then extracted from the boiler drum, superheated in three stages of the superheated tubes. This steam is called the main steam. Then it passes through the turbine. In the turbine, steam is expanded in the nozzles and moving blades fixed on the rotor. The exhaust of a high pressure turbine passes back to the boiler for reheating. After rising the temperature to 540 degrees Celsius, the hot reheat steam is generated, which is supplied to IPT. After the partially expanding this steam in IP turbine, the exhausted steam enters the LPT. The steam is expanded in low pressure turbine to a very low back pressure maintained by the condenser. The turbine converts the steam power to mechanical power and drives the generator. The cooling water is supplied to a condenser by circulating water pumps. Now feed water flow. The condensate collected in the hot well of the condenser is extracted by the CEP, that is condensate extraction pump, which then goes to a deaerator after rising its temperature in a LP heater while flowing, and the dissolved gases such as O2, CO2 and similarly undissolved gases are removed in the deaerator, which is located at the higher level. The air free feed water stored in the feed water storage tank of the deaerator is then pumped by the boiler feed pump through a high HP heaters group to the boiler. Now generation of electrical power. The turbine is coupled to a generator and it drives the generator rotor at a speed depending upon the grid frequency. The regulated excitation voltage is supplied to generator rotor and the rotor is housed inside a stator having a heavy coils of copper bars, and in the electricity is produced through a moment of magnetic field created by the rotor. The electric current generated at a 15.75 kV terminal voltage of generator passes from the stator windings to the step-up transformer, which increases its voltage level to 220 kV or 440 kV depends upon the transmission line voltage, so that it can be transmitted efficiently over a power line of a grid. In this manner, the transportation of chemical energy of a coal to electrical energy takes place. Why the availability of water is important for thermal power station? First, the water in TPS important for the following purpose, that is coal washing. Second is a feed water to boiler for steam generation. Third is to condensate the steam. Fourth one is a drinking. Fifth one is washing. And sixth one for the disposal of ash. For this purpose, the water is required.